When God looks at you, his heart beats out of his chest. He loves you so much. If you think you're less than, if you're shy and that you have less to say, that's okay. But if you think you're less than, that's absolutely not okay. If you live your life trying to dig yourself out of a hole, you're living a lie. Jesus loves you. You're no better than, but you are not less than.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive. Susie Larson is today's guest, and as you're about to hear, she has been through some really tough stuff, starting at a very young age. And yet the Lord has redeemed Susie's suffering and has helped her see her true identity as a believer in Christ. And I'm super excited to share her message today. Susie Larson is a popular broadcast host and the author of 19 books. One of her latest titles is a devotional called Prevail, 365 Days of Enduring Strength Through God's Word. And we'd encourage you to get a copy from us here at Focus on the Family. Here's Susie Larson speaking on the topic of identity at an event called Girl Talk on today's Focus on the Family.
Identity is not something I came by naturally at all. And I just have a little bit of time to give you a little bit of my backstory. But I was raised in a large Catholic family. I knew God was real. I didn't know at that time Jesus was accessible. Around 9 years old, it was around the time my mom needed to get a job to help put food on the table. And around that time, my brother started to hang with some creepy boys. And I was just a small, young people pleaser. I just remember just wanting to follow the rules all the time. And one day, I was walking home from school, and I see my brother's friend's bikes in front of the house. And we had just a close family, a crazy family. But even like when my mom would come home from work, I used to show her the candle with the BB in it, going, "This was meant for me. It's not safe when you're not here." You know, my brothers would be like, "Dance," and I'd be like, "Hop along." You know, brothers were like that. But they really did get into a place and a season where they were hanging with some icky guys. And at this particular day, I remember coming home from school, seeing those bikes, and thinking, "I don't want to be chased with the BB gun. I don't want to be knobbied on the forehead. And there, I don't feel right around these guys." So I decided I would go into the laundry room in the basement, get my favorite sweatshirt out of the dryer, and then go up to my room and read a book until my mom got home. And 9 years old, I'm digging into the dryer, trying to find my shirt or my sweatshirt, and the door shut behind me. And I turned around to see several of my brother's friends, but no brother. And in moments time, I don't know how it happened, where I went from hands in the dryer to hands pinned on the floor, but they had my ankles and my wrists pinned in the floor. And I got up from that place very, very confused about who I was. It was a canyon of insecurity opened up in my life, and self-loathing and fear and all kinds of things. I'd heard a number of things at that age that made me wonder if this was my fault. So I was really afraid to tell anybody, so I didn't. And about a year later, about 10 years old, I'm walking home from school. I was pretty, about 4 feet tall, not much taller than I am now. But anyway, I was walking home and I saw those bikes again, and I remember saying out loud, and this is just so you understand the context of a child who doesn't understand who I was or what exactly had happened to me, but I said out loud, "I don't care if God made me this way. Those boys will never touch me again." And out of the blue, I hear in my peripheral, "Get her." And it was a different group of boys who were getting high in the dugout, saw me walking home alone, and jumped me, knocked me to the ground, and beat me to a pulp. And I remember just curled up in a ball, screaming for help. They were kicking me in the stomach, punching me in the face, pulling fistfuls of hair out. And I just screamed. And they laughed. And they had this crazed look in their eye. And when I got up, I had a fat lip and scratched face and bruised ribs, snarled hair. And I heard in my ear, I don't know that it was audible, but it might as well have been, "I can get to you anytime, anywhere, and God will never stop me." And so I knew God was real, and knew the devil was real at that point. And I have to tell you, that's when fear entered my life. Well, you jump ahead, I came to Christ at about eighth grade. I just loved God, loved Jesus so much. I understood at that time that I was saved, but I did not understand that I was loved. And I would submit to you, many, many Christians live and die who are saved but are not free. They're living and dying knowing they're saved, but they don't know that they're loved. And so I became, as a young adult Christian, a striver. I mean, prior to that, I was an athlete, and so I used all of my talents to dig myself out of the identity hole. And this is just what's true. If we don't know who we are, we will perpetually misuse our time, treasure, and talents to prove something that Jesus has already proven. And it's a colossal waste of our time. We must know who we are. But I didn't. I didn't know. So I'm striving. I'm on five committees. I'm trying to do everything I can to kind of compensate for the wretch that I really believed myself to be. Like I had a deep, dark secret, you know. And got married to my dear husband. And we were going to wait 5 years to have kids. And we got pregnant on our honeymoon. And my husband, and I'm telling everybody, you know, I just was so insecure that I'm like, we waited, I promise, we waited. And he's like, let them think what they want, you know. But anyway, during the first pregnancy, we found out I had endometriosis. And doctor says, you will have a hysterectomy in your 20s. So you have to get, if you want more children, have them now. My middle pregnancy, I was on bed rest for 3 months. My last pregnancy, my third pregnancy, I was on bed rest for 6 months with a 1 and a 3-year-old. And the 1-year-old was strong-willed. And my first one was compliant, so we thought we were good parents. And then we had our second one, and then we thought, never mind. But he was this strong-willed child who spent his life in the corner. I mean, I would go sit with him just so I could bond with him, because I'm like, I never see you except for here. So you can imagine, with 6 months on bed rest, I literally had friends tell me, I'll watch Jake. Like, you'll have to figure out Luke, but I got Jake, you know? And but if you remember the trauma that happened, I was a good Christian in that I was always giving more than I was taking. So to be put on bed rest for 6 months, to have to be at the mercy of people bringing meals, people helping, seeing people get fatigued on my behalf, was a nightmare come true. We were going financially broke, too. And I literally was telling my kids, 5 more months till mommy can make your sandwiches. 4.5 more months till mommy can take you to the park. And yet I'm watching my friends tire out. They're running out of grace. It confronted every fear and insecurity in me. I was getting pretty depressed. I was 6 months along, had 3 months left to go, and I hadn't contracted for a couple of days, so the doctor said, you know what, let's get you up. You're seeming kind of depressed. Let's just get you get up and just test the waters. It was a fall day in Minnesota. Met a couple girlfriends, my old roommates from college, and we just walked along a path. The leaves were falling. It was glorious. I was super careful. We ate lunch. By nighttime, I was contracting, so I was back in bed. And 2 weeks from that outing, I had a girlfriend come visit me, and she said, can I get you water? And I pointed, and pins and needles shot out my arm. And she continued to talk, and this buzzing feeling started at the base of my skull and crawled around to my face, and it felt like there was like a bloodsucker on my face. And I started to have these neurological fireworks. My memory started to go, but I've got 3 months left. And I had this friend at the time who had the gift of discouragement. I don't know, do you have one of those? And I cannot believe that she said this to me, but I was telling her about the neurological symptoms, and she says, well, yeah, I guess it's personalities like yours that most often get MS. That's probably what you have. And I've got a few months left, and I'm thinking, I have exhausted all my friends on 6 months of pregnancy. Kill me now. I couldn't even, because of the insecurity and the trauma and the fear around a disease like that, but just my bigger fear was losing everybody in my life because I would become such a debt to society. It was so scary for me. Well, she left, and again, a new level of fear entered my life. Well, long story short, I delivered my little boy, my third son, and it was dead of winter, and he, around 4 weeks old, got very sick with a respiratory issue. And so here I'm at night doing the night feedings with him, and my face is going numb. I got like a sword going through my leg and pins and needles. I mean, it was just crazy. And I'm like, what in the world is wrong with me? But I'm trying to do the night feedings. Well, at 4 weeks old, he ends up in the hospital with double pneumonia. And I'm sitting in the hospital room with him, exhausted. And I know something's wrong with my body. And I know I have to face it. But I honestly just can't bear it. I've just got on my feet again, you know? I just started to be able to make my kids meals. And I'm thinking, I've got to face whatever this is. Well, they hook him up to his IV, and I'm in the hospital. And all of a sudden, it was like someone poured this oil of joy over my head. And I had my journal there, and it made no sense because every trip to the hospital was costing us money. I'm in my 20s feeling like I'm 90, and I had 3 little boys who were like a party waiting to happen. So I'm like, how am I going to do my life? But here's my little 4-week-old in the hospital. And here I've got all this joy that makes no sense. So I wrote in my journal, God, you're up to something here. I'll take it, whatever it is. When we get him home after a week, and then my health plummeted, and it took a year to find out. They ruled out MS, they ruled out a brain tumor, but my one day off of bed rest, apparently the deer tick latched on, gave me Lyme disease. And when I got the diagnosis a year later, there's the thing, I can get to you anytime, anywhere, and God will never stop me. And this was a fear that nipped at my heels for many years. And I remember, and I was telling Jana, my publicist who's here tonight, and actually I was telling Kay this too earlier today, that I was diligent. I loved God's word. I loved his presence. But I had so much fear and insecurity. I just did. And I remember, as a young mom, battling these memory things, battling the health thing, feeling so much like a have-not. You know, my friends had their health, they had their wealth, and I just constantly felt like he lost my address, you know? And I remember one day studying the Word, getting up from that place going, I don't get it. Where's the victory? Because there's a very big disconnect between what you're telling me and what I'm living. Where is the victory for me? Am I truly a have-not? What's my problem? And the Lord whispered to my heart something so clear, and it was a game changer for me. He said, Susie, I get that you love me, but you don't get and understand that I love you. So until I tell you different, every time you want to say that you love me, I want you to turn it around and say you love me, Lord. So instead of me saying, I love you, Lord, he says, I want you to turn it around. You love me, Lord. And that felt so odd to me. But I said it, you love me, Lord. I'd yell at my kids and then feel bad about it because our life was impossible at the time. And he'd whisper, say it now. You love me, Lord. I'd do something great like finish my laundry. You love me, Lord. And it started to heal something in me. And I thought, is this one of those self-actualization kind of positive thinking things? I got to find this in God's word. And there it was. It's not that we loved God, but that he loved us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. 1 John 4:16, and so we know and rely on the love God has for us. It's not how high we can jump, it's that he stooped down to make us great. When I started to ponder, as Rebecca so eloquently talked about, not about who I was, but who God was, I remember in that place before God met me on that day, I was just so perpetually insecure, and I had a friend trying to make me feel better by telling me how kind and sweet I was, and it didn't help me at all. And I remember one day the Holy Spirit whispered to me, as bad as you think you are, Susie, you're actually worse than that. But Jesus died knowing full well who you were, and that actually was the most honest thing. I needed to hear that. While I was yet a sinner, Christ died for me. And it was another one of these moments where here, we had this thing. It's laughable now. I'm so grateful that God allowed it, even though I never want to return there again. But in the contrast of my friends who had health and wealth, we had none of those things. And I had this dryer that kept breaking. And we didn't even have enough money to go to a laundromat. And we live in Minnesota, where it's winter 7 months a year. Anyway, so when the dryer would break in the winter, I'm almost embarrassed to tell you this, but we'd hang a rope from the living room and hang our garage sale clothes on the rope so they would dry. And battling Lyme, I had a big IV bag hanging from our broken mini blinds, so I would do my IV while I'm drying the clothes. Don't you just want to be my friend right now? Just like, oh my word. But one of those times, you know, the dryer had broken and we had enough money for me to go to the laundromat. And I'm sitting on the bench and I'm reading this passage from John 13. And I had read it 1,000 times before. But you know where that happens when the heavens open up for you almost and the word comes alive? This happened for me. And in John 13, it says, Jesus knew that the Father had given him authority over everything, that he'd come from God and would return to God. So he got up from the table, took off his robe, wrapped a towel around his waist, and poured water into a basin. And then he began to wash the disciples' feet. In those days, the lowliest slave was the person to wash the disciples' feet. And if there was no slave available, it would be the most humble guest. Now I want you to imagine how jarring it must have been for the disciples to be sitting around waiting for the ceremonial washing of the feet, and how jarred they must have been when their Savior got up and then bowed down. And what the Lord spoke to my heart that day in the laundromat is that when you know that you're my idea, that you came from me, just like Jesus came from God, would return to God. Jesus knew that his identity was not up for grabs or changeable with popular opinion or with whatever he was doing in the moment. He brought dignity to everything he did. I mean, the cross was a place of utter humiliation and scorn, and we wear it around our neck. He brought dignity to the cross. He brings dignity to everything. And what God spoke to me that day out of his word is, you know, I'm an image bearer. And if I could understand that I came from God and I'm going to return to him, and in that time in between, I'm not too small for big things and I'm not too big for small things. That in as I follow a risen Savior, I can dare to ask God, do the impossible in and through me. Do amazing things in and through me. And then he can ask me to serve in ways that seem so small and diminished without it ever diminishing me. So my middle son, I told you, my strong-willed one, he was, you know, our first one was compliant and more kind of fine-featured, but we didn't have the money to buy clothes to fit our chubby baby, our second one. And he had three chins and a big belly. And so we squished him into Jake's clothes because we had no money. So his diapers would hang out the edges like guns. And it just fit him. You know, he had the skull on his face. And his T-shirts always were up here. And so he had this big belly and three chins. And he wasn't cute. He's adorable now, but he was not much to look at back then. And I would, like, hoist him up into the shopping cart because he was so heavy, and people would come by, and they literally would do this. They'd be like, oh, baby, not cute baby. They couldn't honestly say that, so they're like, baby. And he'd go, and they would pick up their pace. I'm like, sorry, you know. But he was down the hall, I think 3 years old, on the bathroom, on the toilet, and he yells down the hall, Mom, are you sure I'm supposed to ask Jesus into my heart? And I'm so pleased with this question, so I'm about to launch into my three-year-old theology. And he goes, because I think I asked him into my stomach. This thing is huge, he says. So this is how Luke thought. Well, behind him was Jojo, little sweet Jordan, the one, by the way, when he was a year old and I was getting hooked up with home health care for the Lyme disease, he runs into the living room as a one-year-old with his diaper on, just little Speedy Gonzales. And the nurse who was caring for me said, what is he doing alive? I said, what do you mean? She said, this passes through the placenta 100% of the time. She said, I've just cared for two other women who were bit at 6 months just like you, when a year undiagnosed just like you, both babies went blind and then died. Why is he alive? She said, was he sick? I said, yeah. With what? I said, double pneumonia. He was in the hospital. She said, IV? And I said, yes. What medicine? I told her. When God was pouring the oil of joy into my heart, he was saving my son's life before I knew what was wrong with me. Isn't that amazing? And Jordan, my little Jojo, he's the kid who would walk around a bug before he would step on a bug, you know? And living under the tyrannical rule of Luke, I think he had no other way to be. But he was so sweet. Like, at his birthday parties, he would get his gifts, then he'd redistribute them and go home without any, because it just made him so happy, you know? And there was a day when I'd been thinking a lot about the identity thing. And for me, I have to tell you, I had to contend for my identity. Even though Jesus paid a high price, it didn't feel true to me. And so I had to contend again and again. I had to make the leap of faith to believe that I was someone God loved. And I was in that place wrestling, going, it doesn't feel true, but you say it is true. I'm going to stand on it like it is true. At that time, we were at McDonald's, and Jojo wanted to go back for an extra order of fries, and he was 4 years old, and so he wanted to be a big boy on his own. So I'm keeping the mother's eye. I'm at a distance, and he's holding his little dollar bill. And one by one, people are butting in front of him, and he's getting further and further away from the counter instead of closer and closer. And he's just so shy and so sweet. But I went up to him and I'm like, honey, what's going on? And he just kind of shrugged, you know? And it occurred to me that the boy is not only shy, he's very insecure. God bless you, dear girl. You're like the cutest thing ever. But anyway, even when she sneezes, it's like, you know, anyway. I like snort, but it's okay. I'm all right. I'm secure. But anyway, we really, really realized our little Jojo was not only just shy and sweet, he was very insecure. And we thought, if we don't address this now, he's going to be a spineless husband and a weak employee and a and not a leader that we believe he can be. So we said, this little boy, when God looks at you, his heart beats out of his chest. He loves you so much. If you think you're less than, if you're shy and that you have less to say, that's okay. But if you think you're less than, that's absolutely not okay. If you live your life trying to dig yourself out of a hole, you're living a lie. Jesus loves you. You're no better than, but you are not less than. And your opinion matters. God gave you taste for a reason because of your purpose on this planet. So if you're in a room where everybody likes red and you're the only one who likes blue, you got to say that you like blue because God made you this way. When we started to see him share his opinion at times. You know, how about we try this game? It was just amazing to see. He was still the gentle soul, but the parasitic insecurity was going away, and he was becoming kind of a humble confidence. Well, months later, we're back at McDonald's, and this time he wanted to go into his line on his own for an ice cream cone. And he's standing there with his dollar, and wouldn't you know, one by one by one, people are butting in front of him, and he's getting further and further from the counter. And I'm exasperated. I'm like, have we taught you nothing? And he just knew what I was thinking. He goes, Mom, no. I know I could keep my place in line if I wanted. It's just that all these people look hungrier than me. And like a flash of lightning, that passage from Philippians ran through my mind. Though Jesus did not consider equality with God a thing to be grasped. Think about that. He did not think of his status as God as something to leverage to his benefit. Anybody with any kind of power or position is at least tempted to misuse that position for their benefit in a way that makes other people pay. Jesus leveraged it all right because he could, but in a way that cost him everything so that we could gain everything. Isn't that amazing? And when that's a little picture of my little boy doing the exact same thing, same action, but one was out of emptiness, and one was out of a fullness and a knowing. Arthur Willis once wrote, a right act may be robbed of all of its value in the sight of God if done with the wrong motive. God is not merely concerned with what we do, but with why we do it. I feel like with what Rebecca has said here, we've got to spend so much time getting to know this God that loves us, because when we live in response to his love, it changes everything. This is where the fruit comes. This is where miracles come. This is where life happens. So as I say, you know, identity didn't come easy for me. It was something I had to contend for. But I also believe the enemy sees your potential long before you ever do. All you have to do is look at your childhood. How did he come against you? What's the first memory you have? That would speak to some of the God-given potential you have, because I would say that his threat to you is very connected to your threat to him. So may we stand strong and be who God always intended us to be. God bless you.
What a great message from Susie Larson. I wish I had heard this when I was in high school. It's such a confusing time with so many paths available that will take you one way or another. And I'll never forget when I was 17, I was our high school quarterback looking at college scholarship offers and dreaming of making it to the pros, at least I thought. And my brother Mike accused me of getting a big head, and I had been a Christian for about a year at that point, and I wanted God's will in my life desperately. And so right before the next game I played, I prayed, Lord, if you don't want me to play college football because it'll take me away from you, break a bone today, but don't let it hurt. And sure enough, in the third quarter of that game, I went back to throw a pass, and our defense fell apart. I won't name names. But the opposition got to me, and this huge guy hits me right in the armpit, actually throws me up in the air, then pile drives me into the ground. And I got up, and something's a little odd. It didn't hurt too bad, but underneath my shoulder pads, I could feel my collarbone had snapped in two. So I'm in the huddle, and I reach under and feel that, and I tell the group, hey, I think God answered my prayer. Of course, they thought I had a concussion, and I went out of the game, and that was it. And you know what? That's how God can answer those prayers. I don't suggest he wants you to break a bone to prove your faith to him, but in that case, I think he smiled. He said, man, look at the faith of this 17-year-old boy. And you know what? I was so glad I adhered to it and followed his plan. Mm-hmm. It's been amazing to see how God has been directing my steps ever since. And there's nothing special about me. He can do that with anybody. In fact, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 puts it this way. Trust in the Lord. That's something I did. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. That's right out of the scripture. And I am so grateful that he answered that prayer. So let me encourage you to seek the Lord, like Susie Larson talked about today, to find your identity in Christ and then learn how to walk out his plan for your future. And if you'd like to talk to someone about that, give us a call here at Focus on the Family. We have a very friendly staff that is ready and willing to listen to your concerns, to pray with you, and provide resources if that's needed. And if your situation warrants it, they can also request a call back from one of our caring Christian counselors. This is a free service that is provided by us because of our generous donors. And it's an honor for us to be able to start someone on that road to help and healing. I'd like to say that here at Focus on the Family, we've built a great engine. We just need the fuel to keep it running. And that fuel is the support of donors like you, especially those who can partner with us on a monthly basis. It doesn't have to be a large amount. It's the consistency that really helps us balance our books month to month. And if you can make a monthly pledge of any amount, we'd like to send you a copy of Susie Larson's wonderful devotional called Prevail, 365 Days of Enduring Strength Through God's Word, as our way of saying thank you for being part of the team. If you can't make a monthly commitment, we get that. We can send a copy of Susie's book for a one-time gift as well. Get in touch with us today and get Susie's great encouragement for your daily walk with the Lord.
Yeah, donate as you can and get your copy of the book by Susie Larson, Prevail, when you call 800, the letter A in the word family, or follow the link in the show notes. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team here, thanks for joining us today. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once more help you and your family thrive in Christ.